So yesterday we stopped at after we had created the mounting points and we had created a joint for the two motors. Okay. So now I am going to create a sketch on the base part. And I'm going to show how you will coincide the three holes for drilling. Okay. So there is something called project function. So if you say, if you click on the feature, it will project it on that plane. Okay. So this is important because you cannot take, you know, like hover around in midair and then try to draw circles. It's not an accurate way to create the part. Now if we zoom and see, there is like a representation circle which is there. So this again depends on software to software. Some software they project a solid circle, that means you can directly extrude it, okay, you can remove material. Some software will project a imaginary circle or like a representation circle. Now these three holes, if we see, these three holes are actually going to be having screws going through it. Okay, now let's say 3 mm screws are going through it. That means you have to drill a hole smaller than 3 mm. Okay, and the standard itself gives that value. Now, for example, M3 requires a 2.5 mm drill. So, first what I have done, I have made all of them like just for representation circles. Okay. Now, we will take the circle tool and we will draw. So, 2.5 mm. So let's say this program is loaded on this file, the base part file is loaded onto a machine which is doing, let's say, CNC machine. Okay. So there you will know that you have to actually put a 2.5 mm drill first. Okay. Some systems may have automated drilling, that means it may pick the exact drill bit. Some systems semi-automated, where it will do all the, you know, all this shape creation, removing all this material and all it will do. Finally, you have to load the drill bit yourself. So once that sketch is ready, again we use that extrude function. Okay. So you will use the extrude function. So sometimes when you hover around, it may not do correctly. So we are going to click all three. So you should not accidentally click the other geometries. We are not extruding them. So that's why all these, you know, GUI based tools should be very careful. Like if there is some software behavior, now you are hovering your mouse around, you should not accidentally click something else. Then you have to undo. See, now I click that entire surface, but doesn't make sense. So you have to press escape. So you undo the command. Okay. Now you again start clicking one by one. This part I can skip. So if you know the thickness of the base plate, you can directly give the value, or there is another option of, you know, like extruding it until the bottom surface. So we order through hole, hole through the entire base plate. This one, okay. So if you see, we are calculating from this surface to here how much the shaft is protruding out. Yesterday we discussed, right? If the shaft is not protruding out, how will you put the screws? Now, we will draw that wheel just as a part whoever has come today. So, a part you create a sketch, then if it is a wheel anyway we are going to create a circle. So it is around 36 mm, around this size, the wheel will be around this size. So that was your question, right? So if it is like, it's on the bottom side, it will be too small, the speed will be very, very low. Okay. So here itself you can create this. Since it was a 2 mm shaft, we are creating a 2.1 mm hole at the center. Correct, the wheel has to go on inside the shaft, not inside the shaft has to go inside the center of the wheel. Now again this wheel width and all is left to us, okay. So wheels when you are making, you should not make it like fully solid all the time. You can remove off holes. So here what I am doing, I am creating a thin section which is fully solid, then only in the outer periphery there will be additional material. Okay. So again project geometry if you use, you can project the entire outer circle itself, then I create one more circle. Now we will project this outer surface only, this outer surface we will project it. Means the amount of wheel which is in contact with the ground is high, but at the same time you are saving weight. Okay. If you use a solid like a cylindrical block, then you will be wasting. It's a waste of material. It's a waste of material and it's a additional weight on the entire motor. So on top of this, you can remove some chunks of material here and there, like you can remove some circles. That's why like bike and car wheels and all, it won't be like fully solid. This material removed because it's an unnecessary weight. But you should not remove material such that it becomes weak. Okay. That's where all this bending and you know like stress analysis is done on any structure. So this software doesn't have, I think, that kind of analysis. Now, some softwares will have stress and bending analysis as part of it. Okay. So where what you can do, so this wheel, I will ground any one point, that means that it's standing on that point and I can apply a force on the opposite end. And we can see how much the entire circle is getting compressed. So some softwares have that feature. Now what I am doing, I am creating a protrusion here to tighten the wheel against the shaft. Would you paste the wheel on the shaft? Not a good idea, correct? In the perpendicular direction, you want to put some screw which will hold the wheel tightly against the motor shaft. Okay. So, that is a good practice. On top of that, on the top of the shaft, there is something called as Loctite, okay. So, Loctite is like a gel, which if you apply, it's like a temporary Fevikwik, okay, which ensures that vibrations will not actually loosen the shaft against the wheel, okay. It won't permanently fix it. So, this is a professional thing used in all products, okay. So, they'll use that like a gel like thing so that there is no vibration which will loosen things. Now, I am giving this rectangular portion so that there is sufficient depth of screw. See, either I have to create a bigger circle here, which means it's again unnecessary weight. There is a screw coming only from one direction, right? So, I will put more material only in one direction. This circle need not be there, quite a thick circle. Again, weight saving. So, you can keep changing. You want to see the geometry, how it looks like. So, once that shape has been created, so we'll extrude that. Now, this portion has to come beyond this surface. Otherwise, again there is a problem. So, if I am putting my screwdriver from this direction, this will block the access to the screw head. So, this has to protrude a little more than this surface. So, now for strength can give fillet. So, yesterday we spoke about that. So, fillet can be given for strength also. This has almost like a breaking behavior. That means this part may just break off from the surface. So, you want a continuity of material. So, material should not abruptly end. Okay. So, this is one option. See, that surface is protruding beyond this wheel, so that you can access, you can put a screwdriver, you can tighten it. Okay. So, assembling is a major thing in industry. When you are designing parts, you should design in a way that you can assemble all parts successfully and you can, for repair purposes, you can easily remove off parts. Correct. Building a product is not just finished, not design fast, I have done something, not like that. Should imagine how you would repair the device. That means that before even prototyping, if you can imagine, you know, how I can repair the device, that would be the best option. Again, you save prototyping cost. So, now on this surface, we have to put the drill. So, this 1.25 is a drill for 1.6 mm screw, okay. So, that will again be available in if you search Google itself, if you say M1.6, they will tell what is the drill, basic drill that has been done. And it is always best that it is little close towards the corner. If the shaft is coming from this side and if I keep the hole too deep, then what will happen? You may not be guaranteed that the shaft is going the entire length, okay. So, that again depends on our design. So, now this is an example of extrude where I can tell extrude till this surface. So, I will select that feature. Now, I will tell extent, I am not going to give the distance. I will tell to that surface or to object and I click that cylinder. What it will do? It will go and it will make a patch hole till there. Now there are two holes interfering and it forms a very weird 3D shape. So this is done. So this part can actually be now CNC machined. This is the shape I was talking about. Otherwise, if I give distance, what will happen? Either it will go excess or it will go less. You cannot give exact distance, right? This is a cylindrical surface and you want to extrude from a flat surface. So now that part is saved, again we will drag and drop just like that earlier. Okay. So in this software especially what happens, all these files are not on your machine, so they are given a cloud storage. So these files which are editing are mostly on cloud directly. That's why it takes lot of time. So now you drag drop this wheel, then you will rotate the wheel. Okay. And you will almost like you will take it as close to the wheel as possible. Or to the motor as possible, then we will have that joint. Okay. Okay. So, second wheel has been put, again it is rotated. Okay. First, we just keep them in close proximity. If you are anywhere going to put constraints, it's not needed that you have to keep it in close proximity. No matter where these two parts are, if you constrain it, it will come and join. But the trick is more of usability. Now if the software is, you know, being little sluggish because file is getting loaded, by the time I selected one axis and then I zoom out and then I zoom into the second component which is there somewhere far away, your software may hang. Okay. So these are software behavior. So you have to actually become like, you know, like user friendly to the software. So I click that axis to that axis. So now it went and got joined there. Okay. And define how much distance outside it has to be. Again, this is just for representation. Anyhow, whether it can be exactly fitted or not, we have ensured through design. This is just for representation. We are putting all of the parts together. So I was trying to pull the wrong axis probably. Now if you see, this wheel is just protruding below this flat surface, and any of wheels we won't use directly. So we have to have a rubberized material which you would actually, you know, buy and you would paste on top of the wheel. Because my aluminium wheels directly means it will slip, aluminium or any metal. Same thing again, so we go to the second wheel, we apply the same constraint. So if you go to that axis, it will show up that. See, it shows that access. Then you click that, then you go to the second component. Yeah. Once we click that, it automatically goes and gets constrained there. More or less, this entire file, that was a step. Okay. Now, regarding this base and all, you see, all this material is extra. These are not needed, this is not needed. So, you will put a fillet. Fillet is again like a semicircular thing or a smooth. This will be easy to handle. Otherwise, whenever you are picking the robot, it will be having a sharp corner. Now, only last one part is remaining, which is to create a part for mounting these sensors. So, that part, interestingly, will have a lot more complications in drawings. Okay, almost takes 27 minutes to create that part. So while going through that, I'll explain. Like, you know, like lot more constraint functions you can use in Sketch. So, I am going to create a new part. So, I know what is the width and how much space is available to put the sensor. Okay. So, now I have to open the data sheet. So, now I have to create some holes on this part so that this second part can sit on the base part. Correct? I cannot paste this second part on the base part either. So, in product development, any number of parts are there, it is going to sit on another part. Okay? There will be always one base part. So, this has to get bolted or it has to get crimped or something like that to another part. So, again, let us say we are using 3mm screws. So, that is left to us. And this is part of our design. Let us say we created a part like this. So, this is like a base. So, on top of this, I have to now create towering structures which will hold the sensors. So, I will create a central axis just for representation. Okay. So, I will call it as a construction line. Do we know the speed setting of VLC?
Okay, final.
It's like 2x speed, I think. So what we are trying to do is that we are trying to create a small rectangular region inside which this sensor will go, and there are some thin side walls which will prevent the sensor from coming out. Okay. The sensor PCB will go into this, and the lens part will get stuck somewhere in between these two. Okay. So now you have to create one which is facing front, the remaining two which are facing left and right. Means you have to be, you have to imagine how the entire polygon has to be drawn. It's a polygon, right? It has multiple edges. Okay. Now you will pull all the dots, points and all. Now there is a constraint which can actually set a like a collinear constraint between a point and a line. Collinear means the line, if you extend, the point lies on the line. That's what collinearity is, correct? First, these sizes we have to mention. So that sensor had a width of 8 mm. Now I'll have to give a lot of clearance if I have to do it in 3D printing. In CNC machining, the clearance is lesser, okay, because there is more accuracy. Even a nominal manufacturing will give you, let's say, 100 micron accuracy, 0.1 mm. But in 3D printing, let's say both sides there is an error of 0.2, 0.2. Okay, that means the actual size can become as small as 8.2, even though you are given 8.6. Okay. Now I don't want the PCB walls to be scraping these walls, so that's why a little more extra slack. Okay. But I would want these walls to actually snug fit. Means it has to have a friction against the front part, so it will stay firmly, and whatever gaps will be there, we will fill with some, either a gel like a silicone gel, okay, or some rubber material, so that by vibrations these sensors don't come out. This is a collinearity constraint. So I selected this. Okay, I think full is drawn first. So let's say, yeah, you see, I select those two become collinear or parallel. Now if I move these any one point around, this thing will auto adjust. See, if I am pulling this, this also gets pulled. By constraining things, you can ensure that your shape doesn't get destroyed. I am pulling this dot, but now these things also came front. If I am pulling this, and let's say I am pulling this dot, now this also goes to the right. So what order the constraints has to be given, again it depends on the designer. Okay, so I could have drawn the entire geometry, okay, a closed polygon, and then I start giving all constraints, but it will be over complicated. So this is more of the imagination that the designer will develop over time. Now again, this T shape, I don't have to make it accurate. See, there is a T shape here, there is a T shape here. First, I can make the T shape full, I will finish the construction, then we can start giving constraint. What is the depth of this, what is the width of this. So again, you see, there is a perpendicularity constraint. So I took the point and I made it perpendicular to this line. So this line perpendicular to this line. Or constrain a dot onto a curve. I think this is constrained a dot onto a curve, I think. So again same, so this was 8.6 mm, this is also 8.6 mm. So you see, till now we never drew such a, you know, like more detailed sketch. Okay. So real parts like cars, airplanes and all will have sketches which are very, very detailed. Okay. So there will be lot of features in just one sketch itself. Even medical devices, smartphones, your smartphone parts and all will be like having lot of details in it. Now there is a nice advantage. What you can do is that there is, I think there is a reflect function. Let's see how this has been designed. So first you put all the constraints, whatever constraints need to be done. Fast forward a little bit. So now if you see, this edge and this wall are very close by, means there will be not much material, it will be very weak. So I have to bring this entire thing little front. I mean, this cannot be so far from this. So I brought this to the front, so that there is enough space here. Now this can also be brought to the front. So when you are drawing sketches, you should see any sections which are too thin, too thick. So I reduced the distance, now it got a nice slack here. So now what I did, even though I had drawn it, I am intentionally deleting it. Initially I thought I will draw the whole sketch, but now I realize that there is a way to actually mirror. See, there is a mirror function. First I have to click all the features that needs to be mirrored, because this sensor is facing this direction, right? I can mirror it about this line. Okay. I have already put all these constraints. Now I don't have to repeat this entire process. So once I click the mirroring line, see, it created the entire thing. Now we will just join using this dot constraint, this dot to this dot and this dot to this dot. Then I will set a distance constraint between this and this, just like this side. Which is also not needed, I think. I think if it is symmetric anyhow, it is going to be at the same distance. Yeah. Now I am going to set the distance between this and this point. It was too small, let us say I have made it like 1 mm. So the whole thing came little more to the front. See how many dimensionings are there. Now if this is being given to a CNC machine operator, then we have to make it more differently actually. I am assuming this is 3D printed, because this 90 degree and all, you cannot remove portions. We talked about it yesterday. Now once the sketch is over,
So I click that, take a suitable height. See, it has some complex geometry now. So this each sensor will go into one of these slots, and you either you fix it with gels or you put a rubberized material and like tight fit it. This can be 3D printed. Okay. 3D printing will also reduce the weight of the entire thing. Now you can adjust some sketches if you want some sizes you want to vary or something like that. And another thing, the same two holes which we drew there, we have to actually draw here also, correct? That was plain hole. These two holes will have thread, so that you put that sensor part on top of this, put two screws. So again, because it's a 3mm screw, we have to draw a drill of suitable size. Now when I am giving the size, I should not give it in a way that I will place the part exactly close to the back wall. Again the same clearance issues. What if your 3D printed part had printed slightly long, bigger, okay? So even though this width and the width of the other part is same, you should not place it exactly at that point. So it means that part will now slightly protrude out. So you have to shift the hole little front. So clearances and tolerances are something which will be there in all things. Now for example, if you take electrical also, resistors will have tolerances 10%, 20%, capacitors will have, voltage regulators will have, everything will have tolerance. Similarly, mechanical tolerances. Mechanical tolerances are more distances or hole sizes. This is also that most softwares have. Now until you do some extrude operation on a sketch, the sketch itself will be visible. Once you do the extrude operation, the sketch will disappear. That is a generic, like, you know, way that they have designed it. So the aim itself is that you are creating a sketch, then you will extrude. Once the extrude operation is done, the sketch's use is done. So it goes to hidden mode. See, after the extrusion was done, the sketch disappeared. It goes into hidden mode, not like gets deleted. You see, by the time we drew everything and all, this already has come to version 19. So the actual assembly you are updating, right? Means if I go to version 1, you will find the original part. Somewhere if you want to change, you can take the previous version. So now again, similar to earlier, we will actually just drag drop that. Again you rotate, you bring it to a suitable position. Okay. So after almost arranging it, so now we can have the same thing. So I will constrain, we can constrain this with the base plate, you can use the joints. So I use a joint function. So we have this sliding joint. Sliding joint means that now I am going to use surfaces. I will select this surface and I will say that it will slide along this surface. There are different joints which you can try out. See, it nicely places it on that surface. Surface to surface contact. Next, by chance I think it got aligned, holes got aligned, but we have to actually align it. So you do assemble again. Oh, I think I am just directly assembling. So now this surface to this surface. So sometimes this direction will get swapped. You have to select the surface correctly. Okay. Sometimes when you are hovering the mouse around, it will show a plane orthogonal to your plane or 90 degree to your plane. That is what was causing the issue. So now if you click the plane correctly, okay, so you are able to place it. So these are all for representation, whether you are able to, you know, like assemble it correctly, you are able to place it correctly. Almost we have completed. So you come to the end of the entire creation of the robot mechanical design. So the more often you save, the more versions it will increment. So you can always, you know, keep saving. So you will have a step to go back to. So now we'll just see for visual purposes. This PCB is too high in the air. Which gives a wrong sense, you know, like maybe it's too thick or something like that. Now you can push it down. This is again just for visualization purpose. See, it is well within the wheel itself. Only the antenna is protruding out. So wheel is 30 mm, it's around this much. 80 by 80 by 30 is the total size. I think you're done.